I mean, her husband's dead. David sent Bathsheba to his house. She became his wife and bare a son. But the thing, notice what it says, that David did, the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. The next thing I want to bring your attention to is the time that elapsed. The time that elapsed. God gave him time to repent. The Bible says that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance in Romans chapter 2, verse 4. You know what I think sometimes? I think God does let us get away with some things sometimes. Because of his mercy.
Right.
Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 and 23 says, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed because his compassion is found not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. You know, I'm so glad that God has not really given me what I deserve.
Amen.
I was in Ezra chapter 9, verse 13, that he's given us less than our iniquities deserved. I didn't think about all the time that God has given you a chance to repent. Maybe your sin this afternoon is not fornication, not adultery, not pornography. Maybe something to do with immorality at all. But God has given you chance after chance after chance, time after time, through the preaching of the Word of God, through the rebuke of a brother in Christ, or through the Word of God, a time to repent.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. And yet, you still will not repent.
Mm-hmm.
Some of you sat through the whole camp meeting, and you still didn't repent.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, come on. I think about how he gave Jezebel space to repent, and she repented not of her fornication.
Right.
God's a very long-suffering God, amen?
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I really do thank God for his long-suffering. Amen? Right. I really do thank God for his mercies. And you may think, though, like David did, hey, it's been a year or two, 3 years. I'm okay now. Nobody knows the thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But guess who does?
Yeah.
God.
That's right.
Proverbs chapter 15, verse 3 says, the eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the evil and the good. God sees everything you do. The Apostle Romans chapter 2, verse 16, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ. You're still quiet.
Mm-hmm.
See, it wouldn't surprise me if someone's doing it here.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing surprises me as an evangelist anymore.
Yeah.
I go, I find out this missionary is no longer on the deputation trail because he's snorting coke in the pastor's parking lot.
Huh.
Cocaine. Not coke, like, have a smile, right? He did have a smile, but it wasn't from the right coke, amen?
Huh.
And there's things that are happening again and again and again, and it just surprises me.
Hmm.
I'm going to say right now, I know the Lord's had a lot of mercy upon me, and there's things I've done even after I got saved that I'm ashamed of, and the Lord gave me time. Lord's giving you time.
Right.
Some of you may have committed adultery 20, 30 years ago, and you think you got away with it. No. I remember one time my wife and I, we were counseling with a married couple. They were married for about 29 years. Time we married, counseled with them. And her husband committed adultery 27 years ago. He was in some Asian country. He was messing with some prostitutes and messed up. And he did it when he was drunk, and then he did it again when he was drunk. And you know what? It hurt that woman so bad. Amen?
Mm.
Now, God may give you a chance to repent. He did repent.
Mm.
But there's still some hurt there.
Right. Yeah. That's right.
And even though God gives you time to repent, I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to take a long time for the healing in your marriage. I didn't say your marriage can't be restored. I didn't say it can't be reconciled. I didn't say divorce is an option, by the way. Because with God, all things are possible. With God, you can reconcile something like that. Amen? Right.
Amen?
Amen. You may think tonight you got away with that sin in your own heart and life. But be not deceived. God is not mocked.
Right.
For whatsoever man soweth, that shall you also reap. In Galatians 6, 7. You'll always reap more than you sow. You'll reap later than what you sow. And when you reap, you can't stop the harvest.
That's
right.
Amen?
Yeah.
I think about that scripture in Ecclesiastes chapter 8, verse 11. It says, because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, therefore the heart of the sons of men is fully set in them through evil. I think that the old saying is true, give a man enough rope to hang, and he'll hang himself. David had all that time to repent. But what was the outcome? I'm just about done. Look at chapter 12. What was the outcome? Look at verse 15. And Nathan departed unto his house after he rebuked David. And the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife bare unto David, and it was very sick. David therefore besought God for the child, and David fasted and went in and lay all night upon the earth. And the elders of his house arose and went to him to raise him up from the earth, but he would not, neither did he eat bread with them. And it came to pass on the seventh day the child died. And the servants of David feared to tell him that the child was dead. For they said, while the child was yet alive, we spake unto him, and we would not hearken unto our voice. Now will he then vex himself if we tell him the child is dead? But when David saw that his servants whispered, David perceived the child was dead. Therefore David said to his servants, the child dead, and they said, he is dead. Which leads me to my last point, the tragedy. The tragedy. The tragedy. See, what are you getting at? A child has to die.
Right.
You know, your consequence of adultery, your consequence of immorality, your consequence of sin, whatever it may be, can cause someone, an innocent life, an innocent person to die.
Right.
Think about it. Somebody innocent had to die for you.
Yeah.
Somebody innocent always gets caught up in your mess of sin.
Mm.
Yeah. If you're drinking, it hurts the marriage, it hurts the kids. If you're on drugs, it hurts those around you that are not doing it. If you're messing with pornography, you know, it hurts the marriage. There's things that you can do in life that will bring tragedy in your home.
Right.
And I think about what David did. Here's David. You know what he did? He didn't turn his back on God. He turned to God. And he fasted. And he prayed. And he asked God to heal that child. You know what God did? Nothing. Because God gave him all that time to repent. And God goes, Dana, turn it back. Now I have to follow through with what I need to do. See, God knows what it's going to take to get your attention.
Right.
God knows what it's going to take in your life to get you to get a hold of Him.
Sure. Yeah.
And from this point on, David's a different man. Yeah. Amen?
Amen. Yeah.
And as a result, as I preached to you youth last week, we get that wonderful song, Psalm 51. Cause me to rejoice, which the bones which thou hast broken. Man, what a terrible thing it is when tragedy strikes up. It's one thing to hear about something happened to somebody in their life, and they go, man, that's really bad. I feel so sorry for them. I'll be praying for them. But it's another thing, and it's different when tragedy hits your home.
Yeah.
Wow. And now he lost his testimony before the heathen. It's always a bad testimony when you fall before the heathen.
Right.
And what was the tragedy? Did the tragedy stop at the death of his son?
Yeah.
No. His daughter Tamar was raped.
Right.
Incestuous relationship by Amnon. Number two, raped. That's horrible, isn't it?
Mm.
The child raped. One of them was raped.
Right.
And then you got the other one who was killed by Absalom. Absalom killed the brother for Amnon for raping the sister.
Right.
It didn't stop there, though.
Right.
Then he had tried to run the throne.
Right.
Who? Absalom. Now David was running for his life.
Mm-hmm.
The protective hand of God was off of David.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you, when you mess with sin, the protective hand of God is off your life. Are you listening this afternoon?
Yeah.
Are you taking heed to this? Is this serious enough for you? Is this what the Lord wants you to have? I
think so. Yeah.
Because God is helping me with this, and this is literally in the pew.
Right.
And I'm not taking the glory. Trust me, I know you're praying for me, and mm-hmm. God's interceding
right.
for me. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. But this is what the Lord laid upon my heart. You better
mm-hmm.
count the cost
right.
of your sin. You say, well, you know, I can do it, preacher, and then I can still get married. Let me tell you, when you start fornicating before you're married, it has a way of haunting you in your marriage.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Listen to me. Listen to me. You can't get those images out of your heart, your mind.
Mm-hmm.
You hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Whatever you're doing, young man or older man, tragedy will strike your home.
Yeah.
It's never worth it. What is it? What is it worth? Is it worth your kid? Is it worth your daughter being in an incestuous relationship, incestuous thing happening to her? What's it worth? Hey, listen, your sin will cost you more than you're willing to pay.
Yeah.
It'll take you farther than you're willing to go.
Yeah.
And it's never fun to reap. It's fun to sow, like Brother mm-hmm. Gene Hall said. It is fun to sow.
Mm-hmm.
But it's never fun to reap.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Right.
You better count the cost of your sin. I'm talking to you this afternoon about counting the cost.
Right.